next speaker is Erica Opendorfer. And Erica is one of the applicants, I'm not sure the right word is, for the Barbara Lawrence Award, our Best Student Award Presentation Prize. Said that wrong, but you guys know what I need to talk about, Forgotten Farmers in Labrador. Thank you, Erica.
Thank you, everyone, for being here. And I'd also like to thank Aunt Nellie Winters for coming all the way from Lakota to talk this morning and for being here. I'm going to move to the other side of the coast, the other country now, off Labrador, and the title, What the Blaze is what I said when I realized that the original title for this talk, Forgotten Fires, already existed as a title for a book on Indigenous fire management, so I'm really sorry about that. My name is Erica, I work at the Labrador Institute in Goose Bay, which is where I live. So this is Goose Bay in the summer of 2012. These are fires from Shahajit and Northwest River, where my husband's family is. And these were fires that evacuated the communities. They were only one of 37 fires burning. This is the area centered around Happy Valley, Goose Bay, and down towards southern Labrador. So there were a lot of fires. It was a very active fire year. The next year, summer 2013, this is the view out my front door. Looking at fires that were burning 500 kilometers away in Lab City and Wabush, which did a lot of damage. And this is by no means an exception. This is a map centered around Upper Lake Melville, as you say at the bottom left of your screen. Since 1966, the fires that have burned in the region, so it's a very active fire region. Which you would expect since it's in the boreal forest, which is a fire system, and where many of the plant species are adapted and need fire. The ignition source in the boreal forest is often lightning, and of course there's also other ignition sources, and that one of them is people. So we acknowledge there are accidental fires, and there is also arson, and there is anthropogenic climate change, which is increasing both the frequency and the size of fires in the Canadian North. And so this poster was just the funniest one I could find of preventing the madness, the relationship of people and fire and forests, and coming from a fire suppression tradition in support of forestry. But there are many, many other relationships with fire, of course. Indigenous fire practices the world over, as fire is a tool for crafting landscape, creating habitat diversity, for clearing and maintaining travel routes, and for tending plants, just some of the hundreds of examples. Fire is considered a sacred responsibility in many traditions, and also a living being. And I would encourage you to look at a wonderful thesis by Shalom Jowdry, who did a fire history of Nova Scotia and Mi'kmaq, so which she just finished last year. And so why are Labrador's fire histories with respect to humans important? Well, I think because Labrador fits into this idea of, one of the so-called last remaining wildernesses, and as a large unpeopled area, which of course, this photo demonstrates is completely untrue. This is Sheldon Anderson and his son Eldred. In the foreground, there's some rhubarbs, so Inuit have introduced species to this area. Species have been moved around. There's been soil enrichment over many generations through diet, bones, eggshells, and we see some of the similar patterns. It's really interesting to hear about work on the West Coast of increased species richness at human sites. So I think that fire is one of the elements of recognizing the role of people in the landscape and how landscapes are offered. So the relationships between forest, fires, and people in Labrador have really shifted in the view in the past 100 years. And as an example, I'll give observations by Albert Pilot, who was a geologist coming through, who observed, he thought, at least one half of the forest has been removed by human-caused fires. Then you have 100 years later in forestry journals, Labrador described as an uninhabited wilderness governed by natural processes, and in a paper on fire history in Labrador, not a single mention of people. And Labrador is essentially unchanged by people. So these are starkly divergent views. So I'm going to start by saying what I wanted to learn a little bit more about the role of fire in Labrador and looking at historical relationships with fire through archival work about relationships and practices of indigenous peoples and also the visitors and traders. And this is just the, of course, to consider the source. This is George Cartwright, a trader who spent 16 years in Labrador, but these are the observations of visitors and not practitioners oftentimes, and their language obviously reflects that. So one of the intentional uses of fire, which is quite common in many indigenous communities, is to promote berries and berry productivity. I didn't find any mention of this historically in Labrador or in archival work, but I did find use of fire for improving bear hunting. So indirectly, this quotation here, burning large areas in order to stimulate berry growth in order to hunt bears. So this was the only use I could find, or only mention I could find of fire with respect to berries. But of course, many other mammals enjoy berries. And I put this photo up here because this is my husband picking blueberries at one of the areas that I showed previously having burned recently near our home. So it's not to say that berries were not the direct focus of burning. Caribou. Caribou are the lifeblood of in many ways of indigenous cultures in Labrador. We know that caribou have a kind of tenuous relationship with fire. Large fires are very destructive to caribou habitat and lichens, but small-scale fires can actually have benefits for caribou by improving habitat diversity and green forage, predator avoidance, so being able to spot your predators, and also reducing the amount of horrible black flies that that swarm caribou. There is some archival evidence that there may have been fires set to improve caribou habitat in some of the Moravian archives. We do know for sure that they were used to, that fires were used to signal successful hunts and also to alter caribou routes, to change migration patterns, to improve hunting opportunities. Just some other fire practices briefly. Night fishing with birch bark torches for spearing salmon was noted by Hind in the mid-19th century. They were used to create habitat diversity generally, and then all sorts of things, signaling, ceremonies, cooking, and heat. And Hind writes extensively about fire and relationships with fire. Some of the observations by later visitors, like Lowe, observed that when schooner captains left southern Labrador on their way home with their schooners full of fish, they would set the woods on fire because in next season they would have a ready supply of dry firewood, which obviously caused problems for local people having all of their fur-bearing animals burned out. Gardens is another description of uses of fire, so using wood ash and fires to fertilize gardens. This is a Labrador garden, not a very successful one because these are ash. So yeah, need more wood ash. But, this is another account by Cartwright in the late 18th century that you can read through it, but he's talking about, you know, he saw a pile of brushwood and he was afraid he was going to be sacrificed, but in fact it was the local, you know, Lavina on the south coast who was signaling ships offshore because he wanted trading opportunities. And later on in Cartwright's writings, fire practices for signaling ships are adopted, and he talks about running up to a hill and setting the woods on fire to attract the attention of his boats offshore. So you can imagine there's a lot of fires and that some of these fires spread accidentally. There's one account by Davies in Northwest River. This is one of the areas in that original picture that was burning in 2012. The whole mountain from top to bottom was one sheet of fire. The fire lasted upwards of 3 weeks and spread over, you know, many, many hundreds of square miles. And this was from a signal fire that went awry. Then you have cooking fires that went awry. So you had, you know, Cartwright trying to cook a venison pasty and oops, set the woods on fire. He fortunately saved the venison pasty, but the woods burned and he lost a bunch of other things too. So lots of areas burned by accident. So all these authors talk about these disastrous conflagrations and a huge portion of Labrador Peninsula burning and one half of the forest area of the interior being totally destroyed. But who do they pin it on? The wandering Indians, who set fires either through carelessness or intentionally. And Hind goes on to speculate that fires have become more recent, more frequent in recent days because of contact with Europeans and access to new technologies like powder, flint and steel, and the common friction match. But then Hind goes on to say that he observed the caution with which the Niskafi or Innu put out their fires. And I would say that this is a tradition that continues today. This is a photo from the Labrathon during the Labrador Winter Games, which tests the skills of a traditional Labrador trapper. And one of the events is building a fire and lighting a kettle and boiling water. And you can only proceed to the next event if you successfully extinguish your fire. So I maintain that fire control and fire safety is enshrined in much of Labrador culture. So nowhere do these authors talk about their own role, the role of the wandering Europeans, in a time when they themselves were much more frequent in the interior. And one person who wished to remain nameless said that fires were set intentionally in coastal areas to drive local people from the best fishing berths by ruining the other opportunities around them for harvesting. So I'd like to proceed to some of the contemporary relationships with fire to close the presentation. This is Aunt Annie Evans teaching Marilyn Faulkner and Megan Anderson how to make a smoke pot in McCovic, where most of the contemporary work is based and where Aunt Ellie is from. So fire is used at family cabins to burn grass, to create new green grass, and also to suppress rodent populations. And it's only done during spring when the conditions are wet and when there's less chance of setting the place on fire. Macavimute and many Labradorians preferentially harvest burned wood, so that when you go and get your firewood, because many homes are heated by fuel wood, you go to an area which has been burned by a fire and you harvest burned wood. And these are some of the examples of the different wood piles, so a lot of dry wood, and actually some of the knowledge of combustion properties of how these woods burn in a stove give rise to their local names. So Todd Broomfield talks about fir, or ver, Aedes falsiniac, or pelagituk. I would have to ask if you can say that. That it burns hot, and it don't last, so it's called summer wood, because summers in Labrador don't burn very hot, and they don't last. This is John Winters, who's holding carving a caribou from a poplar, and he talks about how when Old Man's Head burned, which is an area just from McCovic, across the bay from McCovic, they were some glad, because it provided ready access of burned wood for fuel wood. And he also notes that it is a perfect opportunity to go and harvest other important species from burn, like poplar, for carvings. This is Randy Edmonds digging blackberry heath, or in Antietam, it's called crowberry in other places, sod, and smokehouse. So it's not just wood that burns. And this is Aunt Nellie describing how rotten wood and blackberry sod work to smoke your fish. So rotten wood is really good. You put the berry head, you start the fire, and you put the berry head over it, and then you put the rotten wood on top of that. That could be damp wood, rotten. And then you put the sod on top. That's the way we used to do it. Smell from the berry head and the rotten wood makes real good smoke. And that is how you smoke your fish. So this is Aunt Annie again making a smoke pot, and she talks about how her mom would use to make a smoke pot at their fishing place to smoke out the rooms to keep away the flies. They'd put it out by the door and it kept the flies away. And down on the stage head when they were working with the fish, they would have one going also to keep the flies away. So there's also a fire in important cultural events in Labrador, and in McCovic, Bonfire Night, also known as Guy Fawkes Night in other places, is celebrated by families lighting bonfires all along the shore and going visiting and having candied apples and just a really great social event. So it's a fantastic time to be in McCovic. And Nellie talks about, in this drawing of hers with the little Inupiaqs, New Year's in her home in Okok Bay, where they would set trees on fire to celebrate the New Year. You'd tuck the tree over there somewhere, put it in the bellicatters, you'd stick it up when it was quite mild and it would freeze in, it would look some pretty. Then on New Year's Eve, they'd light it. They'd make sure with the stick that it was going good, a bit of coal oil. They'd light that and it would blaze up. It was a long time burning because it would be a spruce tree. So I'd like to close with the most beloved of Labrador relationships with fire, possibly, which is the boil up. This is my husband's grandfather. On the left, Harvey Mondew, and on the right, John Blake, each sharing a fire on their track line, but with their own kettles, because you have to have your own kettle. And it got me to thinking that it's not just large-scale conflagrations that are important in the context of Labrador, but these small-scale, persistent, over time going to a favorite place to have a boil-up and a Labrador tradition in the woods that may be with low fuel, low temperature fuel, softwood, enriching soils, and creating another legacy of people in the landscape, in the very peopled landscape of Labrador. So thank you very much, and thank you to all the Macavimute contributors.